Sardinia and Corsica are two islands unique in the world. Ancient forests of oak and cork represent one of the largest forested areas in the whole of the Mediterranean basin. These landscapes of natural beauty appear before the eyes of the viewer as imposing and wild. It is impossible not to be left breathless by their unique views. The two islands appear as a vast expanse of trees, shrubs, and grasslands that live on gentle slopes and rugged peaks contrasted only by the intense blue sky. In these woods live mufflons, wild boars, weasels, martens, wild cats, and foxes. The king of the area, however, is the Corsican deer, which is the conservational symbol of the islands, which, with its fascinating antlers, lives protected by the thick vegetation.
The Cervus elaphus corsicanus is a subspecies of red European deer and is present only in the islands of Sardinia and Corsica. It is in need of ad hoc protection laws from the International Union for the Conservation of Nature. The species is endangered according to the IUCN Red Book of 2004. The Corsican deer has been classified as specifically protected by Italian law. A non-endemic species, the Corsican deer was brought here by man 7,000 years ago, but it now lives exclusively on the two islands of Sardinia and Corsica.
The scientific name Cervus elaphus corsicanus ex-leben was first observed in Corsica, even if the animal was almost extinct on the island in the last century, to be reintroduced only at the end of the 80s. It is distinguished from the nominal European species with respect to some morphological aspects, such as its insular conditioning. It feeds on a basic diet of leaves and herbaceous plants. The dimensions of its body are smaller than the European deer, and its color is darker. The male will rarely reach a weight of 130 kilos, with a shoulder height of 100 centimeters, while the female does not exceed 70-80 kilograms in weight and 80 centimeters in height. The male has antlers, improperly called horns, deciduous, thin, and branched, fixed on the frontal bone. The females live prevalently in groups with the small and the young, while the male, recognizable precisely for its antlers and its larger size, live alone for most of the time.
The project LIFE 1 Deer, 2 Islands, involving the provinces of the Medio Campidano and of the Oliastra, the Ente Foreste of Sardinia, ISPRA and the Parchi Regionali Nazionali du Corse, has as its main objective the preservation and protection of the animal. The LIFE project for the conservation of the Corsican deer stems from the need to create the conditions for long-term preservation.
In the late 19th, and especially the early decades of the 20th century, coinciding with the wide deforestation, the intensification of hunting, pastoral fires, and the spread of breeding domestic animals, the deer saw significantly reduced both the intensity of its distribution and its area of habitat, notwithstanding a law in 1939 which in Sardinia imposed a total ban on deer hunting. All of this led to two particularly dangerous conditions for the conservation of the species: the fragmentation of its suitable habitat, the reduction of the population size.
Since ancient times, man has always changed his surroundings through hunting and agriculture, reducing the number of animals, and then importing animals from one place to another. In many cases, primitive man brought animals into the places he colonized. And this is what occurred with the deer 6,000 or 7,000 years ago.
The This deer, introduced into Sardinia and Corsica, probably from the north of Africa by man in prehistoric times, would have evolved into the current subspecies, although recent genetic surveys propose a phylogeographic genetic hypothesis, assuming instead an Italian origin. Up until the 19th century, it was described as being common and abundant in the two islands. At the beginning of the 20th century, it was distributed in Sardinia over all the mountain ranges, even if by now at a reduced density. Later, the fragmentation of the territory and the consequent drastic reduction of their habitat reduced them to three distinct Sardinian area zones: Arborese, Sulcis, and Sarabus. In the 60s, the Sardinian population was estimated at between 100 and 200 examples, while in the 70s, it was extinct in Corsica.
The Corsicans had restricted the last 3 to 4 heads to the National Hunting Reserve of Casabianda in the 60s, and that was very much below the survival threshold. And practically, the deer went definitively extinct. Unfortunately, at that time, the animal disappeared completely. Organizations like the park did not exist, and sensitivity to the environment was not the same as today. And so, the animal went extinct. The spark was ignited when we discovered that the deer was extinct in Corsica. There was the danger that this could also happen to us.
At the end of the 60s, the Corsican deer was included in the IUCN Red Data Book as one of the most endangered species on the planet. Between the 80s and the 90s, 14 examples were transferred from Sardinia to Corsica in acclimatization pens to Cuenza and Casabianda, and then progressively released into the wild.
So this collaboration with Corsica in 85, it led to the transfer of a nucleus of 4 animals, 2 males and 2 females. And so we got in 2 specialists, a veterinary expert in anesthesiology to carry out the anesthetic aspect of their capture, and she was accompanied by a German baron, a specific choice, a hunter with experience in the capture of wild animals using a syringe-firing rifle. And so together we made the first catches. There were in fact captured 2 males and 2 females. And 2 years later we transferred other animals. Four females and 2 males. And from there, the Corsicans, with whom we are always in contact, began the repopulation, which I know is going very well.
Today in Corsica, about 1,000 animals are present.
Today, the vision is very different. Even in the least accessible territories, there is the awareness of the value which the presence of these deer brings to the territory.
Thanks to the interventions of the two regions, for several decades now, there has been a notable increase in the animals. The conservation of this herbivore, the largest animal present in Sardinia and Corsica, is important for the maintenance of the biodiversity and for the fruition of tourism on the two islands.
Today, the deer is seen as a collective heritage of Corsica. That is over and above being an element of the island's biodiversity. Effectively, it could rapidly become a vector of economic development and also wealth for the territory.
In Corsica, the Parc Régional du Corse has been collaborating with the French national authorities since 1985 for the safeguarding of the deer. The park has organized the first transfers of the deer from Sardinia and continually carries out sustainable policies related to the protection of wildlife species and their habitat. It is also an active member of the management group of the great ungulates of Corsica.
Well, for now, our main concern, which is also our goal for Project LIFE, is the safeguarding and preservation of these animal populations, so that what happened in the 60s, that is the extinction of the Corsican deer, will never happen again.
Today, the deer is present in Sardinia, with good population densities in three areas of the island. Sulcis, Cervus, and Arborese. Other small populations derivating from reintroduction programs are present in Ogliastra and Medio Campidano areas, and near Olbia, Tempio.
And from the 70s, there were implemented safeguarding projects for the protection and repopulation of this animal. And these have brought the deer to a present population of over 7,000 examples in the whole of Sardinia.
All these populations, however, do not have the possibility of contact and therefore of genetic exchange between them.
At this time, the species has a very fragmented distribution area. Many of the new populations created in the two islands are isolated and thus have a low genetic variability. It is therefore necessary to intervene. The population went into what is known as a bottleneck. In the last century, we've passed from a large number of individuals to a few hundred. This has meant that the genetic invariability in the population was very reduced.
Isolation and reduced exchanges of individuals can reduce genetic diversity and the potential for adaptation, increasing in time the probability of extinction of small populations. The evolution of the regional environment has radically changed in recent decades the environmental framework of the fauna and the distribution of the deer population.
The presence of this animal is important in this zone. Many people, citizens and tourists come here not only to admire the mining environment, but also because of the presence of the Corsican deer.
The reintroductions, in fact, more than being important from the naturalistic point of view, have brought economic benefits through an improvement in the use of recreational tourism in the area. The positive economic effects derived from the presence of the deer, a source of attraction for hikers, far exceeds the costs incurred for its reintroduction.
Restaurateurs and hoteliers take kindly to the presence of the deer as a source of attraction that draws large numbers of tourists.
The existence of the deer is seen positively by the population as an icon of the area that attracts many naturalists and Italian and foreign tourists, but also in negative terms. The demographic and territorial explosion of the ungulates and the passage to an intensive agriculture characterized by the cultivation of valuable crops have created new leading players and new forms of conflict. In Costa Verde, the deer often creates problems to human activities, both for the many damages it causes to agriculture and for the risks that it creates to traffic and the safety of citizens.
In recent years in Sardinia, a conflictual situation has come about, because if it is true that we have 7,000 specimens, and we still have a great deal to do, if we are to ensure that this animal is no longer in risk of extinction, this population is also grouped into three large areas. In these areas, the great nucleus of these animals turns its attention, from the nutritional point of view, not only to natural environments, but also cultivated areas. There have been created conflicts, given that the animals eat the grazing areas of goats. Thus, on one hand, the protection of these animals must be taken care of, while on the other hand, attention paid to the protection of the inhabitants and their economic activities. Yeah, but how much do these deer eat? Now that in the territories of Sardinia, we practice a certain type of zoological evolution by means of grazing meadows, well, naturally, when a deer comes, it eats everything. And in that way, the farmers, the livestock raisers, and the people, they complain, and there is discontentment. The province of Medio Campidano had problems as regards the coexistence of shepherds and deer, especially in the Arbus, Guspini, and Villacidro areas.
I like the deer. They are beautiful animals. But in this area, unfortunately, there are too many of them. I have a small family-run farm, which is called L'Aquila Genas, at 450 meters above sea level. It's situated in a protected area, and so all the animals there are protected, except men. A deer eats as much as about 6 goats. The grass, which is food for both species, must be divided between the two species. According to me, in this area, these animals should be either moved or culled, because there are too many of them. In this way, we'll be able to live more serenely and not hate them. Hate for an animal is a bad feeling, because those who live in the country have a deep love for animals. Yes, because as I said before, he who lives in the country and is a farmer loves all kinds of animals. To make milk, you need grass for the goats. Without grass, goats cannot survive. They just can't survive. If 30 or 40 years ago there were thousands of goats living here, now every farm has had to reduce the number of goats from 700 to 250. Before, there were about 1,000 goats. There is the will to farm, but there no longer exists the conditions to farm goats. We have had to reduce the goats because there's no grazing for them anymore. I'm not saying we should completely eliminate the deer, for God's sake. We just want a right balance between us and the deers.
We should create a management plan which takes account of the two contrasting problems, the increase of the species on the island, but also the end of social conflicts which the species generates. And so we have this ambitious objective, which is to lower the level of present conflict. Already the province of the Medio Campidano had set up the actions that served to mitigate the load on home pastures, creating specific grasslands for the deer, and that was to lessen pressures on the farms.
There have been finances provided for grazing pastures at the expense of the agricultural operators in the area to provide forage for the deer, to make possible the movement of these animals between two protected areas.
The LIFE project, therefore, foresees ecological corridors to other zones, so that the threat to farming is diminished.
The same actions will prevent its isolation where it is present in low densities. Moreover, in order to increase the possibility of contact between the diverse populations, and therefore a genetic exchange between them, there exists the necessity to create new areas in suitable territories.
The project involves the movement of 120 animals, 40 of which in Corsica and the others in various zones of Sardinia. And this would create 4 new nuclei.
The introduction of new individuals coming from a different area will increase the genetic variability, giving rise in this way to new populations.
Thanks to the LIFE project and to the cooperation between the two islands, some animals will be transferred from Sardinia to Corsica, and this will increase the genetic heritage of animal populations already present. This is very important because it will diminish considerably the risk of inbreeding and therefore of extinction.
To establish new populations of Corsican deer or increase the size of existing ones, it has been necessary to identify areas suitable for the realization of interventions of capture and restocking. A detailed mapping has been carried out of the habitats of the release areas. These will be successively used also for the analysis of the radiotelemetric data and for the monitoring actions.
As part of the LIFE project, ISPRA is conducting a feasibility study for translocation and reintroduction in suitable areas, both in Sardinia and in Corsica.
The feasibility study was carried out according to guidelines developed by the specialist reintroduction group of the IUCN.
We have created models of habitat suitably specific for the Corsican deer, beginning with the present distribution areas. We have reconstructed other important areas for the deer. And so there has been created a map which is used to identify sites of entry to the two islands.
The release of animals into a completely new environment is particularly critical. One must therefore carefully choose the intervention areas, taking into consideration all the factors capable of promoting the success of the project. All available data has been used regarding the use of the habitat by the species of animal studies with radiotelemetry in previous projects. Nocturnal localizations during the monitoring with thermocameras, localization of deer calls, camera traps, and other signs of presence. The monitoring of an animal population represents the starting point to document its state of conservation, and the case of huntable animals, the sustainability of the amount located. To this, there must be added that through a correct estimation of the population trend, it is possible to identify the conservation strategy and most appropriate management. The use of the thermal imaging camera allows for the identification and counting of the animals in complete absence of light sources. Since, in particular, the deer demonstrates a generally elusive behavior and habits, which are prevalently crepuscular or nocturnal, a count carried out at night by means of the use of a thermal imaging camera increases the probability of contact with the animals without causing disturbance to them. The instrument allows observation through the infrared radiation emitted by the animals, even in the case that they are partially hidden by the vegetation.
Well, during the census in the forest, the transects move at night when the animals are active. Using the telecameras, we are able to verify the presence of the animal at night. The instrument allows us to identify the species, perfectly recognizable by the shape, which is completely different from other animals. Adopting this method of census, we can count the animals, and by means of distance sampling, we estimate the animals present over the whole territory, even by means of the percentage of animals which are not seen.
Between the end of August and the month of October in the forests of the two islands, the roars of the deers can be heard. The roar is a characteristic noise emission made by dominant males during the mating season. This raucous and prolonged call allows the individual to warn his fellow deer of his presence and signals the start of the breeding season. In the mating season, the adult males gather in herds, conducting spectacular combats and launching their roaring love calls. The starting point is represented by the number of reproductive males and therefore love roars present in the study area. In the months of September, patrols of two people each position themselves in previously identified places. There have been created listening points, situated normally in elevated positions, such as hillocks and saddles, so as to allow the maximum acoustic coverage possible. Once in their positions, they remain in silence to listen to the calls of the adult males and to record their direction on the special forms.
From the gathering of this information, it's possible to estimate the population density.
Ne sentiamo una a 280. 280 gradi. Distanza 2.
Ora.
Ora.
Each location is assigned two detectors equipped with survey forms, compass and a picket on which is mounted a dial protractor with a moving pointer and showing the 360 degrees of a full circle, and the four cardinal points with the north coinciding at zero. One estimates the distance of the deer's call and the number of deer, and the other has the task of registering on the card the information gathered, which serves for the subsequent processing of the data.
One of the major risks for the conservation of the Corsican deer is constituted by the consanguinity of individuals, leading to a consequent loss of genetic variability.
We work in a genetic laboratory for animal conservation. We deal with the study of wild populations. We carry out phylogeny studies, genetic studies of populations, analysis of kin, monitoring and characterization of individual genotypes.
There was therefore carried out the genetic characterization of five populations in Sardinia and three in Corsica. This action, preliminary to the introduction of individuals into the wild, has served to define in a precise and rigorous fashion the genetic criteria on the basis of which the most suitable areas were selected in which to obtain the individual founders.
This program is very ambitious because it allows for the concretization of a good number of objectives and to improve the monitoring and the study of the populations both in nature and in the pens. A study on the genetic immunity was carried out in three enclosures, which demonstrated up to what point our animals are no longer suffering consanguinity. The project aims to transport deer into new areas of the islands, and that is for two reasons. The transfers from the Medio Campidano in Ogliastra serve to expand the destination areas of these animals. That's with the hope that their number would also increase. However, in Corsica, the main aim is the renewal of the genetic makeup.
The transportation of 120 examples of the animals is foreseen. The catches take place in Monte Arquento Rio Piscinas, in the territory of the Cantiere of the Ente Forest of Crocorigas and in the surrounding areas. For the capture and for health monitoring of the animals, there have been created three capture precincts in the source areas and four stationing pens in the release sites provided.
Here we are in the capture precinct. Here the deer are attracted by tasty foods. Once they've entered spontaneously to eat, they are captured and put to sleep with the tele-anesthetic techniques. The capture pen is divided into three sectors, the first where the capture takes place, and then where they are attracted by appetizing foods. This enclosure becomes almost a meeting place where the deer can find this type of food.
At sunset, it goes to forage in the pen and waits patiently. The deers, drawn to the forage and the grains, enter the capture area. When they are in a suitable number, an attendant closes the gate, thus trapping them in.
It's very important in the preliminary phases of capture to know the frequency of visits to these fenced areas and the habits of these animals, how many enter, and what are the most popular seasons for frequentation.
The enclosures are fundamental to allow for the capture of the animals without problems and to ensure their health control until their final release into nature. Once closed in the enclosure, the specimens are sedated with the use of a veterinarian's blowpipe.
Praticamente cosa succede? Gli animali.
Well, practically what happens? Once they are in the pen, the animals cross the fence. And once they've arrived in this last sector, this is closed. And they are sedated with the anesthetic. A syringe launching rifle or a blowpipe are used if the deer are at a minimal distance.
Operating in conditions of safety with the individuals in a controlled situation, it is possible to sedate a number of animals at the same time.
Once the deer are sedated, the operations are carried out, the possible sanitary analysis, measurements, and weighing of each animal.
The animals are inspected, blood samples are taken from them, and the morphometric weighing and measurements are carried out. First, a health monitoring is carried out, with particular reference to brucellosis and blue tongue.
Quite often, the illnesses between wild and domestic animals are related. We must have the absolute certainty that the animals which have to be transported are in a good state of health.
The individuals which test positive to critical pathologies will not be used for the operations of reintroduction. Before the transfer into the corral housing, the animals are fitted with radio collars and ear tags that will enable their localization and recognition in the places of reintroduction to verify the effectiveness of the operations. The ear tags are applied that allow rapid and unequivocal identification at a distance.
And this allows us to constantly study the movements which the deer make in the territories of the liberation.
For the capture operations, marking and fitting of radio collars, the presence of a group of support operators is necessary. The captured animals are transferred to the release sites located in the protected areas involved in the project in the briefest time possible. The movement is carried out by means of live animal transport vehicles, either pickups or trucks, inside specific wooden boxes. The action will allow for the translocation from the place of capture towards the release sites Supramonte Vogliena, or Gozzola Nurzulè, Gulf of Orosei and Monti del Gernangentu in Sardinia, while in Corsica, Chenet Vert and Juniperet de la Tartagine, Massif du Rotondu, Massif de l'Ancudine. As regards the transfer to Corsica, the deers undergo a health monitoring before leaving, after which, if they result healthy, they are directly released into nature, without the long climatizing process in an acclimatization enclosure, hard release method. This is the reason why the park uses helicopters for the transport of deer. Transport by helicopter is the least invasive method of moving the animals, and it is estimated the duration of transport is of 2 hours with a load of 3 deer for each journey. The helicopter is necessary given the street conditions of the island to reach the release sites.
Release into nature operations necessitate the participation of the expert park staff. Around 15 agents are involved in the operation. The most delicate phase is the transport to the place where the operation is to take place. Lately, in the framework of LIFE, we have made captures in the Kenza enclosure. 10 captured animals were transported overland by truck or 4x4 along a smooth road for around 4 hours in total safety for the deer. From this starting zone, the helicopter allows for the transport of the animals into a zone otherwise inaccessible, with a flight time of around 2 to 3 minutes. The animals are heli-transported inside individual wooden cases. For each voyage, a maximum of 4 animals are transported. We can make an assessment of the animal released. Once the animals have been brought to the release zone, the cases are opened,
respiration. Et ensuite, une fois que tous les animaux sont
and the release begins directly into nature, where the animals will regain possession of their space.
It is necessary to monitor the new populations, first by means of radio telemetry and marking, and successively to the end of the functioning of the radio collars by means of direct observations. The technology presently available allows to indicate in the satellite collars equipped with GPS the best choice of marking, and radio telematic monitoring of the founding individuals in order to obtain information in real time of their survival, their spread, and the use of habitat of the introduced individuals.
In the zones where they have been reintroduced, at least one half of the animals have been equipped with a satellite radio collar, which allows for the deer to be followed quite regularly. With one of two missions per week in this zone, we monitor the activity to geolocate the animals and have their precise position, and have information on the distance, on the distancing in relation to the place of release, to know the biotype occupied in function of the seasons, the possible disturbance linked to activities such as hunting, the survival of the animals, and if there have been births, because the female examples also have collars. All this requires a great effort in the field because you have to go and search for the data and thus work on a triangulation in two or three people to well locate the animal and to geo-reference it on the map by means of a computer and GPS. And this allows us to follow the animal's movements for the whole duration of the collar, which can arrive at around 4.5 years. And this is very interesting. The LIFE project is important for the safeguarding of this species. The animal is the symbol of the recuperation of a species that we were about to lose. In these last 30 years, we've affronted the problem to the point that the deer has entered into our culture. And so, fortunately, in these last years, we've managed to turn around the trend. And today we arrive at a population of around 7,000 deer. Well, we can say now that the reintroduction operation of the Corsican deer is going to have very important economic consequences for the territory. Why? Well, there is foreseen an increase in tourism. The attraction for this species can really influence tourists and consumers in the territory. The LIFE project between Corsica and Sardinia has a further possibility, because evidently this species is common to both the islands. And it's not possible to foresee a management of the species without a combined action between Corsica and Sardinia, because this will allow for the reciprocal exchange of our experience. Over and above the point of view of a patrimony, which is part of the Mediterranean culture, this project is very important because it lets it be known in France and Italy, but also in Europe, that there are specifics of the Mediterranean, that there exist endemic species to which we must reserve a particular attention.
Et que il doit y avoir une attention toute particulière qui est portée à ces espèces-là.